I hope the recording session is on now. So please check from the ngrock.com the status about the Raspberry Pis, whether they are live and active or not. So you can check it from this. So these two, along with the client IP, is you can you see the URLs. This implies that those Raspberry Pis are live. So once these two Raspberry Pis are live, you can access them either through using PuTTY, or you can use through our Wildwood and Studio to access the one of the Pi, that is NKS Pi 1. So I'm using here PuTTY. You know how, what is PuTTY and how to access the systems remotely. So I'm using one of this IP here. The IP, you can use it, or you can use your URL. You can go through the host name. I am just pasting it. Then, of course, you have to put your port number accordingly, 11932. So once you enter this, select the option SSH, secured shell connection, then click open. If you are not getting with one URL, please go with the other URL if the PuTTY or SSH is not enabled in this. So that's what I told you in the beginning also. So copy the other URL, because those URLs will be interchanged if the Pi is off, and once it is logged in again, it goes with the new URL. So now this one particular Raspberry Pi we are connecting through PuTTY. So it comes this PuTTY security alert. Then you just click the yes. Now it will ask for the login credentials. So you are logging as I. Username is Pi, and the password also I have given to you long back. Can you please recollect what is the password I have given?
SCISNKS99.
Yeah, yes, yes. SCISNKS99. So once you are logged in, you are able to access one of the Pi. So this is this one. And if you are going through Wildwood in Studio, so you can start programming here. If I see the working directories, if you see Irfan, only the one particular Anurag, so they have created their files here. Hopefully this particular Pi is for your second exercise actually. So most of you might have not tried this Pi. This Wildwood in Studio, using the Wildwood in Studio, you can access the other Pi. So you can access this NKS Pi 1. So can you please recollect which sensor is connected to NKS Pi 1? And which sensor is connected to the other Raspberry Pi? So there are two Raspberry Pis. Raspberry Pi 2 is on this, connected through PuTTY, and NKS Pi 1 is connected to your Wildwood in Studio. Can you please tell me the sensors? Two sensors are connected. Hello, am I audible to you, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I think you might have forgot. So one sensor is the DHT sensor. Another is your KY028. Basically, KY028 is an takes the analog values and the analog values of the ambient temperature, and you read the temperature. Read means you collect the temperature through your KY02A, whereas the DHT sensor is basically a digital humidity and temperature. So you are going to collect the digital values of the ambient temperature, and the ambient means the environmental temperature and the humidity. I hope you were now please start practicing. You might have forgot the steps or what, I'm not sure. So at least we please recollect this using Valuetune Studio. You might have practiced using the LEDs and the LCD display also. So this is one LCD program. So LCD is an example for what? Is it a sensor or actuator?
Actuator.
Yeah, LCD is just basically what is an actuator? Just to make a recollection, please. What is a sensor? A sensor is a transducer which converts device which converts environmental phenomenon, environmental or your ambient or your space or your time or whatever your context, that particular environmental phenomenon value is converted into electrical energy signals. The device which converts your environmental value into your electrical energy signals is what?
Sensor, sir.
Sensor, right. So converting from electrical energy into an environmental phenomenon, either to interact with the environment or to control the environment, that device is basically called as
transducer.
It is a transducer, but what type of transducer is that which tries to convert your electrical energy into another form where it can control the environment or it can make use of the environment to act accordingly? Is your actuator. So you're basically, your LCD is a display. So that display, you are displaying something on this device from your electrical energy. That energy is coming from other sensors, or it can be coming from any program to display it on the environment. That's why you call it as your LCD is basically an actuator. Okay. So I think you completely, everything has been wiped off. So please do recollect the basic things here. Of course, we are not going very in depth, but still you need to look to the basics, fundamentals. Very, you should be having clarity and you should be very much clear. I think, yeah, some of you already now join the session. So to recap whatever we discussed for the last, so the material is completely on the Moodle website, week wise, and the topics and exercises, assignments, and as well as the question paper. And of course, you might have seen your marks for the minor one test marks, which are already been posted on the Moodle. And if you are having a clarification, please let me know. And those who are absent for this, I will inform you in the next week what should be done for the assignments or for the, and for the assignment too, already the deadline is extended. So please go through that assignment too and try to complete it. So already assignment one, most of you have completed it, but still assignment two is pending. Assignment two, which is already extended it. So let us see now the recap. Of course, I'm not going to go for a new topic in today's session. I will try to summarize the things for the last 8 to 9 weeks we have done, and let us go for what is I'm going to teach you in the coming weeks. So that will be having a clarity for you now. So regarding the practicals, you please go through these practicals, and if you're not using the sessions, definitely the sessions will be closed. See, we cannot keep the sessions open for hours together for a student who is not using. So once, if you're not using it, automatically the session closes here. It's as simple as that. So if you are using continuously, if you are ready with your program and if you are ready with your execution, what needs to be done, you are having clarity, then please connect it and complete the exercise quickly. That is for please let me know if you have any doubts in connecting these Raspberry Pis and trying to understand what needs to be done. I can explain to you again also. So these are the URLs. And yes, please.
In the second assignment, the first program, can we do it like to while connecting it to some other cloud things, ThingSpeak cloud, like Pranav has a his ThingSpeak cloud is collecting the data, sir. So can I, like, I made my application using his cloud, so is it fine, sir?
See, a cloud is just an intermediary to just to make sure you collect the data and do some visualizations, and you have to interact with this. So if you see the assignment question here, what I have given, so see the let me just reiterate this assignment two question. So what you need to do is you have to develop a Python graphical user interface application for implementing the MQTT subscribe operation to the given demo MQTT publish operation using ThingSpeak cloud. If you have your own ThingSpeak cloud credentials and you have to connect it, yes, it's acceptable. There is no in this. So you can either connect to Raspberry Pi, that is one of the Raspberry Pi that has got Arduino and the digital temperature KY028, or you can connect to another Raspberry Pi. Any one of those two Raspberry Pis, you can connect it. And you know the steps already I have shown to you in this beginning of the session as well as in the earlier sessions too. So how to connect your Raspberry Pis that I have shown. So please, you have to write a GUI using your Python programming language. You prepare, you design a GUI, and that GUI should try to implement this MQTT subscribe operation, which you can use to any of these ThingSpeak cloud, or not only ThingSpeak cloud. You have so many other clouds which are available on the internet. So you can use any one of those clouds. It need not be only ThingSpeak cloud, please. I'm just given one example because I have discussed about ThingSpeak cloud. I have just made you to understand about that particular thing. Now coming to the second part of that assignment. So develop a Python geo application to collect and store sensor data locally in the MySQL DB. So if you remember in the Raspberry Pi that is connected with your DHT11 sensor, it has already got the LAMP stack, Linux, Apache, MySQL, and the PHP parser it supports. So you have to store your MySQL, use your MySQL database to store your sensor data. How to store it? That you have to write in a GUI. You have to develop a GUI so that you can store. So that is your own program. Each one of you will have your own GUIs. Each one of you can have your own design also. Need not be the same design. So please do not copy about those designs. Obviously, the plagiarism comes into effect if you are copying the other person's code. So please write your own codes to collect the sensor data. Already the sensor data is being collected on those Raspberry Pi. So you have to write the MySQL program to store it. So the program, how do you write the MySQL statements using the Python is what you need to just a little bit explore it and try to get it. If not, I can explain to you. So once you can store the data, you can also make a graphical representation of the data collected and displayed. That is what your own program is. That is what the second exercise is. So in these programs, you please write your own logic and you please describe it using the comment statements. That's what it was expected on the assignment too. So once you write these programs, you know how to collect the data and how to store it locally and how to send it to the cloud. Two things, you can get the basic ideas of this. Of course, the sensors may be different, but these two sensors will help you to understand how do you collect and how do you store it locally and as well as in the cloud. That basic exercise, if you do that, that knowledge and that skills will be sufficient to go ahead for further exploration in so many other things. Am I clear now, Bharadwaj?
Yes, sir. Okay. And sir, is in the first exercise, is drawing a graph a compulsory exercise, or else like we can represent the data in our own way?
No, presenting data on the tabular form is doesn't make any sense here.
Okay, sir.
Visualization is the most important thing. See, this assignment is prepared. These questions were prepared at a time where thinking that it there will be a break and there will be an extension to the academic session. It was not keeping in view of those two things. So there will be a break and there will be an extension to the academic session. So I don't want to pressurize, or I don't want to give you more tasks so that you will be. My intention was to for you to complete the task with the minimum capabilities. That was the thing in which it was prepared. But at least if you don't do these two things also, then you may not gain much knowledge. That is the basic things also you are not getting it into that. That is what. So my intention is to at least do basic things. If you do it, then automatically you can later, if you do exploration, you get more information. Okay, let us now move ahead. So we are entering into the third unit. So before we entering into the third unit, so last class we before the break we stopped at the ZigBee and the 6LoWPAN and other wireless communication technologies that have been used in the IoT. So this information is already there on this Moodle website, so you please go through it. But anyway, this recap of today's session, you will get you an idea. And it will be helpful for you to continue further for this remaining 2.5 units. All right, so let us go ahead. And of course, this material for today's session is already posted here. You can see that there is a recap, and of course one small simulator we'll see for today, how to use the simulators. So before going to the simulators, let us see what are the major building blocks of IoT. So this material is available, please download it, and let me go through this material and make you to understand what this particular major building blocks of IoT. Are you able to see my screen, please?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. So if you remember, from the beginning of the semester, in the first week, where we discussed about the IoT architecture. So if you see here, we have seen a couple of architectures, reference models, either which have been useful for our preparing an IoT application, an IoT theme of applications where some domains. Maybe it can be healthcare, or it can be from transportation, or it can be a smart agriculture, or it can be a smart home. Or if you look to the smart grid, anything you take in any application where IoT concepts or IoT themes are being applied, you can see a different kind of reference model. Please remember, as such, there is no, till now, there is no unique model. In the sense that this is the model, or this is the reference things that needs to be considered, like your ISO SA reference model in computer networks, or your TCP IP suite, like that. We in IoT things still it is not come, but a generic concept is been it has been come out from these particular different types of reference models. What is the generic concept, or in general, how do you perceive, or how do you view that particular architecture to be? Or seven stages. So if you look from the bottom up, at the bottom level, you have something called physical devices and the controllers. Basically, these are the things. The physical things which are getting connected with each other, or those physical devices are connected with various sensors or various actuators or various devices and machines. So those all things have been connected with the help of various wireless connectivities or wireless technologies, and you try to collect the data from this set of things, and the data is being realized for different set of applications and for a different set of business decisions or for business organizations, where they will use that data appropriately for their business operations. So these are the seven different layers of the seven different levels which your Internet of Things world form has formulated. So if you look to the Cisco, Cisco also has given different number of layers. Can you please recollect what is the Cisco architecture is basically is concerned about? Cisco is basically a computer network giant or a computer network company. So their focus is on to project that particular IoT things so that those things can be interconnected with the help of various networking gadgets, networking routers, networking gateways, network communication perspectives and all. So the Cisco has formulated their IoT themes of application in terms of other network concepts. Whereas if you see this particular layer architecture, what you are seeing is the IoT World Forum, they have put in terms of things architecture. Similarly, IEEE standards, they go for a different types of things, and Oracle architecture has go for a database perspective. So Cisco has come for from a network perspective, Oracle has come from a database perspective. IEEE has come from the standards, which are those standards which are involved in connecting the things and communicating with the things and performing the data at different levels. So like this, each architecture has come with different layers and all. But in general, please remember the generic architecture, or you can call it as a general model, or the IoT ecosystem. This IoT ecosystem, you can call it as an ecosystem, or you can call it as an architecture, or you can call it as a design model for a particular application to be realized using IoT concepts. So here, this ecosystem consists of four different stages or four different levels or four different branches. Of course, they are interconnected again. So at the from one end, if you look from the one end, there will be a smart things. So what is the difference between things and smart things, please?
Things which communicate.
Things are those devices. In our day-to-day life, we use things. Your bulb, electricity bulb, your fan, your room door, your sitting chair, your table, your glass, your books. Anything, that physical entity which you are seeing in your day-to-day life and you are using for some purpose, they are basically your things. But we call it as smart things. When these things become smart,
exchanging data.
Not only exchanging data.
So when they are able to collect, store, sense, exchange
data. Collect, store, and sense, exchange. Still, you are on the track. I cannot say it is not out of the track. You are on the track, but not coming to the target meaning of. What is this quotes of smart? When you add smart to that particular word things, what happens? Smart.
React to the environment conditions and do suitable operations on their own.
Yes, on their own. Very good, on their own. So it is smart is nothing but it is the other name for smart is intelligence. So intelligence, how these things become intelligent? Things means in your real world, like your car, like you're in your own home. In your own home, you have bulbs, lights, so many other things. So how these objects, the real world objects, are becoming intelligent? How those things become intelligent? Of course, you can, if you can provide artificial intelligence mechanism to those things becomes intelligent. See, by nature, those things are not intelligent. So because we are using those objects in our day-to-day life, we want those things to do, or those things can be used in a better way for our day-to-day life. So how do you make those things in a better way? So how do you incorporate artificial intelligence into those things, or how do you induce intelligence into those things? Can anybody tell me how can you put, or how can you incorporate, how do you induce intelligence into the existing physical things? Anybody?
By using IoT sense, like devices, like sensors to get data.
Yeah. Let me correct. I think Bharat was speaking. Let me correct here. See here, you are using sensors, or you are using actuators, or you are using your IoT devices only to know the environmental conditions or the environment in which those devices are being used. How the you are better utilizing the environment. Environment means it can consist of so many physical things. So how best you want to use your environmental conditions? How best is by making the things intelligent. Making the things intelligent is what I'm asking. The question here is how you can make a thing to act smartly. Of course, we are using those sensors and actuators. Just by using sensors and actuators, the things will not become smart. Please remember.
Yes, sir. Like take the data from those, and then the IoT device will have an algorithm which analyzes those and take decisions based on them.
Yes. So you have to make the things smart with the help of. Of course, without sensors and actuators, you cannot make those your physical things smart. By just simply taking the sensors and actuators, you are just making use of those things for your day-to-day life. But how do you make the thing smart? You have to give some. Those things will not have a brain like us, brain like our human being. Those things will not have a heart like us. Those things only because how do you put a intelligent or your knowledge or your making some decisions wisely? So that is a program which you want to run it on those devices.
Yes, sir.
So here you need to have a processor. Please remember, what is the processor or what is the CPU? A CPU is one which you are going to process the data. So your sensors and actuators will be helpful for you to either collect or send data to your physical things. Not only just sending and collecting the data from your sensors and actuators, but you need to process it. So you need to have a small processor also. A processor which is more capable enough to handle large data. When the data is very huge, how do you handle it? And of course, there is the need for you to store some data. So your brain is going to process yours and store it. And you are using others. So along with your sense organs of our human being, we are using the different sense organs for different purposes. Similarly, there also you are keeping some sensors and actuators to those physical things. But not only just to sense it, but also you have to write your own in artificial intelligence methods and algorithms on to the by increasing the capabilities of those things by adding a processor, by adding a memory, by adding a communication capabilities to those things become smart. Please remember that. So things become smart by adding the necessary infrastructure for those things to become smart. So what are that necessary infrastructure? That by that the things become smart is the necessary infrastructure, minimum things like CPU, your processor, your memory, and your communication capabilities. So by adding those simple infrastructure capabilities of your IT infrastructure capabilities, you also have to write your own AI programs and methods so that those things become smart. So those smart things, once the things become smart, do you call it as a smart things? And from that smart things, you try to keep on collect the data. You correlate the data that is coming from different smart things, correlate it. So for better realization and for better applications, for better business operations. So we do process the data at different levels. So you can process the data at the gateway levels, or you can process the data at the middleware level. So these are the different stages where we can do some kind of data processing. After collecting the things data, you communicate the data efficiently, and of course, looking into the network's QoS parameters, quality of service parameters, like reliability, throughput, delay, all this comes into picture so that the data can be easily processed at different levels. At different levels means again, so this is at the middleware level or at the cloud level or at the server level. So these are the things so that the data can be processed at the for various business operations and for various business purposes. So these are the basic building blocks. Remember, this very simple diagram has got a lot of things that you can talk for hours together technically. So, but nevertheless, these are the simple diagram which will always give you the big picture about the key building blocks of IoT or the skeleton of an IoT. So if you see here, yes, at the one end you have smart things, and after the smart things you have some networks and gateway. So these networks, that is basically networks are meant for you to connect those smart things in an efficient manner. So those gateways are those which will helpful to process the data so that some meaningful information can be generated. It's not that all the raw data should be carried on forward for the other purposes. So here in the middleware, is what you are, you can see the symbols which will tell you this is a data storage and other advanced computing engines so that the data can be processed efficiently for various business operations. Now, these are the elements that make up the backbone of any IoT system, which can affect you that multi-layered architecture. So whenever an application is getting realized, so many layers can come in between, please remember it, in between these layers, or sometimes some layers may not be used for different applications. So some applications require only either smart things in the gateways, the middleware and applications layer may not be required if you're looking for your edge computing and the fog computing applications of your IoT. So sometimes you may have to have more layers here for better fine tuning of the data as well as for your communication purposes. So now let us see here the perception layer. So what is a perception layer? Which you already seen, what does a perception layer contains? Hello, am I audible to you, please?
Yes, sir.
So what is the perception? Perception contains basically you are perceiving the outside world, you are perceiving the physical world. So basically the perception layer is what where your smart things into comes into picture. The smart things which try to perceive the outside world, and those perception will tell you what data to be collected, and how the data should be collected, what data should be collected, and what are the other things that needs to be collected from the environment so that for certain applications you can make some proper decisions. So the connectivity or transport layer is basically transferring the data from your physical world to the cloud, and of course from the cloud to the gateways and this. So in addition to this perception, connectivity, processing and application, that's what we call it as these four layers. Smart things are in the perception layer. Connectivity comes in this transporting the data from your devices to other layers of data processing units. This is basically your transporting layer. And of course, the next layer is your middleware and the applications layer. So this is a generic one. Please remember it is a generic, and this is not even standardized. When I say standardized means we don't accept it. This is to be the only stack, IoT stack to be followed. No. So it is a general one for different applications. The different things can be made use of from that particular basic ecosystem. So of course, along with those floor layers, we also have something called edge or a fog computing layer. So basically, we are the edge or the fog computing layer. That's what I was telling. If you look here, the smart things and the gateways here, of course, the most of the your edge computing do happen. The edge computing is basically, what do you mean by edge computing? This we have studied in the, previously. Can you please recollect it?
We have small processing units near the perception layer itself.
So those processing units will help us to make the decisions very quickly at the source of the data. At the source of the data means that the origin of the data. The origin of the data comes from your sensors here. So near to the sensors and actuators, you have your some processing elements like your processors, which will capable enough to process the data very quickly, very fastly. So you are going to, by that you are going to achieve some kind of the latency problems can be avoided and all. So at least that's the difference, that's what you are called as edge computing. So fog computing is somewhat, it is not exactly at the data source, is not exactly at the origin of the data which comes from the various things, but at least a layer which is above the gateways, here above the gateways, And of course, in between your cloud and to this, that will also help us to minimize the latency, do more data processing, and do some kind of distributed data processing so that different applications need this type of computing layer. So that will give you some kind of inferences for this. So you have a business layer. Of course, this is what your business layers can be having, either in the middleware to make some analysis of those data that has been collected from the previous layers and make that analytics in a more efficient way. For this, you need to require some kind of computing engines. So along with this business layer, you also need to look for the security layer. Please remember, you need to add security. So the data that has been transported from your devices, from your smart things, to the data processing levels. So the security is the another important thing, please. So security to be added at different layers. So at the different layers, security mechanisms are there, from starting from the devices itself and to the transport layer and to the middleware layer where the business operations do take place. And of course, at the cloud also, where the data gets stored or the data gets processed, there also security is very much needed. So here, so what is exactly happens in the perception layer? Can you please recollect it? So in the perception layer, what exactly happens? What is exactly happens in this smart things layer, please? When these smart things, basically you are connecting some sensors to your physical world objects. So those sensors are your actuators. If you look to the sensors will take that physical world objects activity, physical world objects phenomenon property, physical world objects characteristics, physical world objects information is being collected by those sensors. And that information, when it collects data, the way the physical world objects are being used, that data which is collected, some sensors may be of analog sensors, some sensors can be of digital sensors. So most of the time, this perception layer, these smart things, where the sensors and actuators are connected to the physical world objects. So those sensors, if they're analog, the data which has been collected from the analog, or these analog sensors which collects the physical world properties, cannot be processed or cannot be made some inferences. May I know why it cannot be processed properly? When the analog sensors have been used and you collect the data of the physical world objects using analog sensors? Yes, please.
The processor like works in terms of digital. So we have to convert it to.
Yes, perfect. So most of the time, see, we do process the data digitally. Please remember, data is getting processed on your digital computers, on your digital devices. If you are collecting the data in only analog form, that will not help you, or that will not help your digital devices to process the data properly. You collect the data in analog form and you expect the digital devices to process that analog data is not the appropriate thing. Please remember this very fundamental thing. That's why what we do most of the time is these smart things, when some sensors are been connected to the physical world objects, those smart things, what they do is, one of these important thing is, if the sensors are analog sensors, those analog sensors data have to be converted to digital data. Then only the digital data can be further processed by your digital devices, which are there on your gateways or your transportation, or which are there on the business layer processing or on the different at the cloud layer. Because all these networks, your gateways, your middleware devices, and your cloud, all those devices are working in the digital manner. Digital means you use your network routers, you use your network switches, you use your computers, you use your different wireless technologies, you use your different database storage devices. All these devices which have been used for data analysis, for your data inferences to be done, then all the data can be processed only in the digital form. That's why, please remember, the smart things, one of the important activity at the perception layer is, these smart things cannot process the data which is coming from these analog devices. But at the same time, you cannot collect the digital data directly from that physical world. Physical world, that is what your analogous Analogous means you are the real world thing, the real world or the physical entity or the physical or physical object that you are feeling and you are seeing is basically an analogous one, which can give you the analog data. That's why one of this important activity the smart things will do is to convert your analog data to digital data, so that the digital data can be used in various digital devices which have been used in the transporting, and you are processing the data for making some better inferences, for making some better decisions. Please remember that is what one of the things. So in order to convert your analog data, that's what the perception layer, the smart things layer, converting analog signals into digital data. And of course, sometimes if you're using an actuator, that actuator needs some analog data to control the environmental device. So that's why DAC, digital data to analog data conversion, is also required. So please let me know what are the analog sensors that we have used in our discussions during our early stages. Can you please recollect it? So here, the perception layer, the smart things, contains your sensors, basically your probes, gauges, meters, and other physical world objects. They collect physical parameters like your temperature and humidity, turn them into your electrical signals, and send them to the IoT system so that the digital values of those analogous parameters can be made use for your better applications. So IoT sensors are typical small and consume little power, whereas your actuators translating electrical signals from IoT system into physical actions. So your motor controllers, lasers, robotic arms, and all those are things come into picture. So please tell me what are the analog sensors that we discuss, or can you please give some examples of analog sensors which have been used for your IoT systems for various purposes? Can you tell me a sensor that is used to collect an analogous data that can be used in our smart home or your IoT system?
TMP35,
the temperature sensor. Yeah, TMP35 is one basic temperature sensor which collects the analog temperature. So how do you make that collected analog temperature value to the digital form? That is the next question which I'm going to pose it for you. Yes, please.
Sir, any ADC performing microcontrollers is there?
Yes, any ADC, analog to digital converted, microcontrollers are required. So if you see that assignment 2, where is that assignment 2 question? Just now I closed it again. 1 second, let me open. So here, why did we connect Raspberry Pi to Arduino? Please tell me. And to another sensor, KY028.
To convert the analog data into digital data.
To convert the analog data into digital data. Who is converting that analog data into digital data?
Arduino.
Yes, Arduino. Yes, please remember, Arduino is basically... So what is the difference between an Arduino and a Raspberry Pi? Again, these differences also we discussed earlier. You can recollect those discussions based. So Arduino is basically a... What is an Arduino? What is the use of it? It is a microcontroller, yes. A microcontroller, control microcontroller which converts your analog to digital. So how many bits data conversion it takes place? How many bit analog to digital data conversion it takes place? It's basically, is it an 8-bit or 10-bit or 12-bit? I'm giving the options for you. Sorry?
Could be 8, sir. 8-bit.
8-bit. You are guessing. No. It is a 10-bit conversion. Please remember, 10-bit means 2 power 10. What is 2 power 10?
1024.
So your analog value, 5.5 volts is being converted to your 1024. 5 volts is equivalent to your 1024 in the digital value. That's why if you remember the conversions, so please remember, again, recollect those, all this, I think you might have forgot. It is basically a 10-bit conversion. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So yes, where are we now? We are discussing this point now, right? So your perception layer, basically you are using various device. The perception layer, one of the basic activity of the perception layer is to convert your analog signals to your digital data. So why we need to convert analog to digital, I have just given the reason for you and a little bit recollected, made you to recollect those points, and which device is used is doing that one also, we just seen that now. So let's move forward. Then we discussed about connectivity layer, enabling the data transmissions. So what are the different communication technologies or the communication methods that are useful for you to transmit the data? So basically there are two ways here. So what are the two ways? If you see at the bottom of strategy here, you have a Raspberry Pi, or you have an Arduino board, or you have a mobile phone. Some sensors are there in your mobile phone. Suppose you can connect your Raspberry Pi and your Arduino board with some sensors. And of course, if you are collecting the data from these sensors or from these devices, you can send them directly to your cloud or to the server which is there on the cloud. So in order to transport that data, you can use your TCP UDP or your UDP. You know what is the difference between TCP and UDP. So for this, you can use very simple things. Your Raspberry Pis, your Arduino boards can be either connected wirelessly or it can be connected through wired. If you're using a wired connection, you'll be using basically your Ethernet cables. So wirelessly, you can use it through your Wi-Fi and send that data directly to the cloud. That is one way of transporting the data from the collected sensors to the cloud or to the server for further processing and making some business decisions. There is another way also here. The other way is you have used different communication technologies here. If you see at the second diagram on the right side, you can use near field communication. You can use Bluetooth low energy, BLEs. You can use low power wide area networks, or you can use ZigBee. Different communication technologies which are used to establish a network among these wireless sensors which are connected using your Raspberry Pis or use your Arduino boards for various applications. So you collect the data from these wireless sensor networks, and the data is being transported to the server side or to the cloud, where further data processing do happen with the help of a gateways. So these gateways are something like an intermediary transport units which will help us to send the data from these devices to the cloud for further processing. So this is one way. So this is these are the two different ways usually you see in the IoT systems or IoT where IoT has been deployed for various applications, either directly send the data to the cloud or through different gateways with the help of different wireless communication technologies. You can transport the data to the cloud for further data processing. So that's what I already mentioned to you here. Now you tell me what are the different devices that have been used as a gateway that we have discussed in the previous classes. Can you tell me which device did we consider or did we use as a gateway which will help us to transport the data from the sensing device to the cloud or to the
MQTT.
I am not asking about the communication protocol. I am asking a device which is used to transport, a device which is used to forward. Transport means basically sending the data. Forwarding is also here. After collecting the data is being forwarded to the cloud. So what is that? Very simple. I am putting the question in another way, that's all. But you are unable to reason it out very quickly. See, why you are using a Raspberry Pi and you are connecting it to where you are connecting? You are connecting into the ThingSpeak cloud. If you remember, which device did you use to transport the data that has been collected from this particular temperature sensor? So you can use this your DHT sensor, which is connected to the Raspberry Pi, and the data can be forwarded to your cloud. The cloud is basically, in the example, what I've shown you is ThingSpeak cloud. So which device did I use it here?
Raspberry Pi.
Now tell me, can you tell me, we have already also discussed another device actually, which we have considered to transport the data to the ThingSpeak cloud. I have told you, but I have not implemented and I'm not shown you, but it is also possible, which is another device here. Can you at least tell me, can you please recollect it? How many devices did we discuss in our practice so far?
ZigBee?
No. ZigBee is another communication protocol. Please don't confuse between a communication protocol. A communication protocol means communication rule. What is the rule that you followed for communicating the data? See, ZigBee is a protocol. Bluetooth is also a protocol. NFC is also a protocol. LPWAN is also a protocol. Wi-Fi is also a protocol. These are all protocols. Please remember, don't confuse between protocols. Protocols means set of rules. The rules which govern the communication between two different entities. Those rules will tell how data can be transported, how data can be sent from one unit to another unit. Those are the rules. That's all. Don't confuse between the protocols and the devices. My question here is a device, a physical device, which will help you to transport the data from the collected sensing system to the cloud. One device is Raspberry Pi, which can be acting like a gateway. It will help us to transport the data. It will help us to forward the data from the sensing device, like that what you are seeing in this assignment 2 only. So along with Raspberry Pi, the other device which you have discussed is Arduino itself. You can use your Arduino board also to connect directly to your ThingSpeak cloud. Please do remember this point. Of course, we have not done an experiment on this, but it can be made act like an Arduino board which can forward your data. Please remember this point. Okay, now coming to this, in the right side diagram, please understand what are all these NFC, Bluetooth, low energy, LPWAN, ZigBees and all. Of course, 6 LoWPAN, so many communication technologies are there. Communication technology. I can use the term communication technology or a communication protocol or a communication standard. All these three words are same. Please remember, communication technology, communication standard, communication protocol. Don't confuse between this. Communication, the way you communicate between the devices or between a unit to another unit which is located in a different place, or sending the data. These terms remains the same. Until unless you are not involved in the topic, you will not be able to please. You will be getting confused if you are very half-heartedly you are dedicating yourself to this. Please remember. Okay, now my question here is, what are these meant for? NFC, Bluetooth, LPWAN, ZigBee. If you remember in our syllabus, I have written here communication protocols, MQTT, ZigBee, 6 LoWPAN, Bluetooth. What is COAP stands for? Yes, please. Constraint Application Protocol. UDP, TCP, LoRaWAN, these are all your communication protocols. I think you are not referring to the materials I have put on the Moodle. See here, the ZigBee is there, what is UAP is there, what is LoRa is there. I have given the recorded video introduction to communication protocols and one protocol, LoRa. XB is also there, the videos are kept here. And what is MQTT is already been spoken several times. Again, you forgot, I think, or you might have not understood the way I told you. But please remember, if you go through the materials and if you're regular, please concentrate here, then you'll get the things automatically. Okay, what are all these, please? Can you please recollect it at least? Anyone? Yes, please. These are the communication standards. These are standard. Bluetooth is one standard. NFC is one standard. Of course, there are standard numbers are there. I'm not giving the numbers for each standard here. But these are your ZigBee is one standard. You can call it as a standard. You can call it as a protocol. You can call it as a communication technology, communication purpose. What for all these things? These are all this NFC, Bluetooth, low energy, LPWAN, ZigBee, 6 LoWPAN, MQTT, COAP. These are all the things things means here they are all the communication technologies which are been used for communicating among the devices that are connected in this particular physical world. So you can use Bluetooth, you can use NFC, you can use different Wi-Fi, you can use Zigbee, you can use 6LoWPAN. So these devices, the devices or the physical objects, real world physical objects which are connected with each other, how the connection is established, how the communication happens between these physical world objects is through these communication technologies only. These communication technologies, these communication protocols, it can be Bluetooth, it can be NFC, it can be Wi-Fi. So now tell me, what's the difference between Bluetooth and Wi-Fi? Every house may have this Bluetooth and Wi-Fi so far. So forget about my whether I conveyed that information or not. You can tell me now the difference between the Bluetooth and the Wi-Fi. Can anybody tell me what is the difference between the Bluetooth and Wi-Fi? Most of the houses do have this now technologies, almost all houses, and everybody is also aware, because most of them have smartphones, most of them have their computer devices, most of them have your internet connection in your own home, and you may be using the Wi-Fi connection, and you may be using the Bluetooth. So please at least tell me, what is the difference between this Bluetooth and your Wi-Fi?
Bluetooth is for shorter range than Wi-Fi?
Yes. So Bluetooth is for shorter range and for a few devices in your own home. Very shorter range and for very few devices. It can be 2, 3 or it can be 6. You can have a PicoNet. That's the maximum. You can have 6 to 8 devices connected using your Bluetooth. And it is it is used for shorter distances. What about Wi-Fi, please? Wi-Fi. What are the limitations and what are the things for the Wi-Fi? So Wi-Fi is the most popular wireless network and is of a great fit for data intense to IoT solutions that are easy to recharge and operate within a small area. So Wi-Fi cannot go. Can you tell me what is the range or the Wi-Fi signals can be reached for how much distance if you put a Wi-Fi router in your home or in your particular area or your particular office? So it is for a small region or for a small area. A good example of using is in basically Wi-Fi is in your smartphone devices connected to the electrical grid. So there is another technology now, something called as near field communications, NFC. NFC is shorter than Bluetooth. Still further shorter than Bluetooth. Okay, all this material is there here, actually given to you in this particular. If you see this Zigbee for IoT and your introduction to communication protocols, please go through that various communication standards, how much is the range and for what applications it is being used. You can get that complete information here. Here I have given the range also. If you see here, this is the range. The range, how much distance? 100 meter, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, how much distance? WiMAX, data rate is how much? So please do go through these materials and you'll get these materials. You should not forget the information that you gain from these things. Very short and very sweet and very easy to remember also. The only thing is you need some focus. Please don't lose focus. Otherwise you will be missing it. So here for the Bluetooth, you can use it for a very short range. That's what your Deepika has even told. So you can use it for your wearable devices on your body. You can use for your Bluetooth. And of course, I don't want to read line by line. This is a notes for notes point of view I have given you. But what I am trying to explain or you describe here is to make you to understand and think in this direction. So that's your thinking process should be in this towards the IoT application, so that your thought process will enable for you to remember all these things in a more fruitful manner. So I don't want to read each and every line and that will make you to be very bored here. So please go through this. So now comes, actually you know these things actually, the Bluetooth and your Wi-Fi and your Ethernet. So you might have seen in your lab also Ethernet, for what purpose you use your Ethernet. So you can use for wired connections, any wired devices to be connected, you can use your Ethernet standard also to for you to connect those IoT devices if you require wired connection and for some other purposes too. So in addition to this, you have ZigBee. So already in that PPT, you are saying ZigBee is a standard, IEEE standard, which will allow for you to, for what purpose you can use ZigBee protocol? Can you please recollect this? That is there already here now, which I have given to you. ZigBee is a wireless communication. Of course, XBee is a wireless which follows the ZigBee protocol. So what is ZigBee? ZigBee is a specification for a suite of high level communication protocols using small low power digital radios. So you have a small low power digital radios. Radios mean RF, radio frequency. You can use the small devices for low power consumption, which is very much ideal for your IoT devices. So they use very less energy. That's what your low power here. So when you use less energy, that devices can be run for more time. So low power, but long range variants are also available. So you please go through this and how do you connect? This is what some of the examples we discussed in the last classes. The video recording is also there. Please go through it. So again, the differences are already been given here in a nutshell. Please go through these differences again. When do you use and what? Wi-Fi, NFC, Bluetooth, low power, wide area networks, LPWAN, ZigBee, cellular networks. So if you see this connectivity, pros and cons, popular use cases. So in the previous slide, I have given you that this information, extra information, and now comes into picture here. So in addition to this low power communication protocols, the most of the popular protocols, in addition to those, is your MQTT and COAP. What is MQTT, please? I think we already completed this MQTT. Message queue, telemetry transport. What is the use of this MQTT?
For low powered IoT devices.
Yes. Low power IoT devices uses this protocol for what?
Sending and receiving data to cloud.
Yeah, of course, any protocol is meant for your transporting the data, that is for sending and receiving. But what is the purpose of this MQTT when you compare with other communication protocols? Basically, MQTT is meant for your device to device communicate. Please remember, one device can directly communicate to other device. There is no need for a requirement of a gateway or another intermediate device which can forward the communication process. So MQTT will be helpful for us in our IoT applications or your machine-to-machine applications, where those devices can directly talk with each other. Devices can communicate some information to another device directly. The advantage is a device-to-device communications, machine-to-machine communications happens very quickly and very fastly. The exchange of information between device to device is very quick, very fast. But at the same time, there is a drawback for this MQTT. What is that, please? Yes, please. What is the drawback of MQTT? Please recollect this. Already this demonstration.
Security is not encrypted.
Yes, the data is not encrypted. When the data exchange is taking place from device to device without any encryption. That's why it is very fast and very much easy to send from a device to device. But if suppose somebody intrudes between those two devices, one good example is if you see a robot. In the robot, you will see so many devices which are communicating with each other. Device to device communication do happen in the robots. But if you keep some security mechanism for each device to device in the robot itself, either to the arm, to the leg to the brain, if you keep that, those are basically devices. Those are basically your machines. And those machines, if you keep on adding security layers to that, and you want to work the robot in the real time, and obviously it will kill. So if you're putting more security, more authenticated, more encrypted messages, then the processing of that encrypted messages or authentication process will itself will eat away the machine to perform in the real time. That's why most of the time, very simple objects, when they are trying to communicate, when they are trying to exchange the information, your MQTT is the most useful protocol just to communicate without. If you are not concerned about the compromising of your security, then you can use MQTT. Please remember. So tell me how MQTT works. Please tell me how MQTT works. Anybody? Can you please recollect? This demo already I have given to you. So temperature humidity logger, REST API based communication with MQTT through ThingSpeak Cloud. Already I have sent demo and the recording session is there. Python code, everything is there here. This is a real experimental scenario which I have shown in this week number 8 MQTT demo. The recording session is there. Please tell me how this MQTT works. At least please recollect this.
Publish subscribe model.
Very good. Publish subscribe model. So let me just show you now how this publish subscribe model, those who are not able to recollect it, those who are not understood, or those who are not attended that, and those who do not get the time to see these videos, let me show you through a simulator here. So there are so many simulators on the internet, please, for various IoTs, for various wireless sensor networks, and so many things. There are plenty of things are there on the internet. Only thing is you need to find a little bit time and you need to do some practice. That will give you a lot of these simulators, please. There are simulators and emulators, but they are not. They will not replace, they are not do exactly what they are supposed to do in the real environment. Please remember, for academic purpose, for knowledge gaining, and for understanding the things in a better way, these simulators and emulators will be useful. But for a beginner, it can be useful. But remember, when you do really, when you deploy the systems in the real world scenario, then these simulators and emulators are not the right alternatives when you don't have the real devices with you. Real devices will function in a real way. Please remember, these real devices functionality completely cannot be realized by these simulators and emulators. But anyway, for to just learn, for just if you are a beginner, you can, for you to get an understanding how the technologies and how those things are being made use of, you can use those things. So I have provided one simulator link here. Of course, just for you to get some exposure to many simulators, I will be taking some couple of simulators and emulators. Of course, so far we have seen the Raspberry Pi simulator too, using Wildwood in Studio. You might have done some practice. Similarly, you have seen Arduino simulators. Like this, I will be taking some more simulators that those who are which are open source. You need not pay any money for those things, and you can start understanding the things how it works. So now one among them is CupCarbon. CupCarbon, you can download it. The download link I already given to you in the Moodle. So you can link to download the CupCarbon IoT WSN simulator. Most of the simulators and emulators are developed by the universities, from the European universities and other American universities, most of them. So you can download those universities developed simulators. And of course, there are so many limitations with those simulators and emulators, but for to get an idea, of course, this can be useful for you to just to give some basic ideas. So I'm using this CupCarbon. You can download it, just no need to go for any installations. If you have installed your Java, that is enough onto your system. So now you can open this CupCarbon. I'm just showing you for you to get an understanding about the MQTT, how the MQTT works really. Already I have shown you in the previous class. Please go through that. And those who are not able to understand, or those who are not followed that, some of the concepts which are involved in the MQTT, I will just put it you one more demo using this simulator. So you can also later you can practice this. So this simulator basically for WSN wireless sensor networks can be used, because you can apply, you can write your own algorithms on the sensor nodes on the wireless sensor networks. Of course, for IoT also. I just maximize the screens for you. Just let hold on. So the bottom you can see the console, and on the top window you can see this is the window which has got a menu item where you can add many devices and so. So what I'm, of course, this is the background. You see a map. This map definitely is just an indicative, informative, and indicative for you to understand if the devices are placed at different places and how those communication things are going to happen. Of course, so many experiments are there on those websites. Those who are having time, you can explore it and you can understand it. Just for MQTT purpose only, I have taken this particular simulator here. What I do is you can directly select the sensor IoT nodes. So you can connect real sensors as well as you can use the virtual sensors. So what I'm using at present is the virtual sensor. So I am just placing some virtual sensors now. Just click it on this IoT node and you place it here. So here, are you able to see my screen, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I am placing some of this sensor here. So how many sensing? It is a node actually. In fact, these are nodes. These are nodes, or I can call it as sensors. So how many nodes did I place it on my board here?
Four
nodes are there. Four IoT node. I can call it as a node. A node here implies it is already a sensor is there, which is connected to a particular physical device. That's what you call it as a sensor node or simply a node itself. Okay, I connected some four nodes here, and on one side, I'm just placing on one side, and I'm placing another node here. Yes, on the other side. Only one day. Okay. So here, I'm just trying to explain to you. Okay, let me just remove this. One second. Right. So how many nodes are there totally? There are five nodes. Four nodes on one side and just one node on the other side, please. So what I do here is MQTT protocol. Okay, let me just a new project. Let me give you some name to this project. I'm given MQTT demo 2. Once again, I'm repeating, just I'm placing the sensor nodes on one side. So four nodes on one side and one node on the other side. So the node which is on the right hand side basically is a published node. It means, what do you mean by publishing? Publishing means you are going to send the data.
Send
the data. On the other side, you have four nodes which are basically subscribe nodes. Subscribe means the name itself will give you an indication. Subscribing, it means receiving the data. So one person, one node, a sensor node, which is sending the data, and that node data is been received by the other nodes on the other side. Since this is a simulator, please remember. So what we have done in the reality thing is, on the demo side, we have sent a DHT, digital humidity and temperature, that is in the publish mode, and the other side is in the subscribe mode. The subscriber is basically your cloud, which is subscribing to that MQTT data. So that's what you have done in the publish subscribe model in the real demo. But let us try to understand here something which is very similar to that process. So here you can see this there is a MQTT configuration. So this simulator uses this particular broker. So what is the use of means what is the purpose of a broker in the MQTT communication process? Can anybody please tell me? broker, the name itself will give you
it connects different nodes together.
It is not connecting the nodes, rather it will help in exchanging the information between the nodes. It is not connecting, but it is helps in the exchange of information between the nodes. Broker, a broker is an intermediate node which will exchange the information from one node to another node. But broker is a term which is used in the olden days. What is the new name which is given to the broker when you use the MQTT? Very good. At least you remember it. Very good. So usually this is like a server only. Nowadays we call it as a server. But of course, this because we are using different old terminologies, the names will still remain on the internet when you are using different internet web sources. So broker, this is the address here. Mosquito. What is the server which you are used in the demo, if you remember? Yes, please.
ThingSpeak Cloud.
Yeah, in the ThingSpeak Cloud, we have used one server which will help us to exchange information, and you have enabled in the ThingSpeak Cloud. If you remember, I think Anurag has enabled this when he's logged in through your ThingSpeak Cloud. During the demo, I can recollect it. What is the name of that server which is help for you to, which is acting like a broker, which is acting like a server to exchange the information? The name, what is the name of that one? Here, already the name is there in this box. Mosquito. Mosquito here. There are Paho Mosquito, P-A-H-O, Paho Mosquito in the demo which we have used it. And what are the other servers which can be used for you to exchange the information through MQTT protocol? They are also there. Can you name another server which will be helpful apart from Paho Mosquito? Yes, please. And the default port number of this Mosquito server is your 1883. 1883 is the port number, default port number. You need not change anything on this simulator, please. Please do not change anything. It will, by default, is running in the background. If you are connecting a real node of your either Raspberry Pi or your sensor node, you can give that particular information over here, and you can assign this particular name to that particular node. And of course, in this MQTT, if you are using any a specific username, you can also give the username and a password. So I'm expecting an answer. Apart from Mosquito, Paho Mosquito server for MQTT communication process, what are the other servers which are available for us when you use the MQTT? Please try to find out that answer before the end of the session. Anyway, you have the computers with you, you can even search it, at least search it and tell me. Okay, in meantime, I'll just try to complete it. So but that is a default Mosquito server which is running in the background to exchange information between this. Now you can use this this simulator. You can also write your scripts here. So you can use your Python, the Python programming language, to write the scripts, to write the programs. The programs, in this case, in this example, what we are doing is the understanding the publisher and the subscriber. So if you see, there are already some sample programs are there for publisher. And similarly, if you click this button, subscriber is also, the program is a little bit written to you. You can customize this and you can see the results of this one. So now can you tell me, of course, this is you are importing the time, this is your Python script you are writing. So while node, that is a node, in this program which you are going to embed into this particular node. So that's what you are going to embed it. So you are going to give some name to this particular file so that that script is going to run for that particular node. So something like this is basically publisher. So I'm giving a name to this file, publisher 2. So now tell me, can you see these instructions which are written in this loop? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Okay, now tell me what is the first line, please. Please read out, no problem. Anyone?
Node.publish.
Yes. So what is mean by node.publish? If this program is given to a particular node, IoT one device, that node is going to publish it. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Publish means you are going to send the data. Publish is nothing but sending the data. But yes, what is written in these quotations is important here. What are these parameters? Please tell me.
Sir, could you maybe increase the font?
One second.
So this is the topic and then data.
Sorry?
It is first the topic, in the which topic it is publishing the data followed by the data.
Topic and followed by the data. That's, you are explaining the arguments here. Okay. So let me just put it here. Those who cannot see that instruction properly, I have just taken instructions here. Can you see the instruction now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So now this is the first line, node.publish. So what is written in these arguments, the parameters for this publish command? So here, something called topic. Topic is the most important thing for your MQTT. So what does a topic contain? Can anybody tell me? I have given, please recollect, what is a topic? This is a topic, carbon, cup carbon slash sensor, followed by the data. The second parameter is the data here. So what is a topic? A topic will identify, a topic will distinguish, a topic will give you some information about the origin of the data. So if your topic is something like 101 followed by some sensor 100. Similarly, the topic is a unique identification which will help the MQTT protocol to identify from where this particular information is coming. So here, a sensor 100, which has been connected to this particular cup carbon network, is sending a data 1. After this particular instruction is over, what is the next instruction, please? Please tell me, the next instruction is time.sleep. So this node is going to sleep for 2 milliseconds, or you can make it as a 2 seconds, it's up to you. After it has slept for this, again the node is publishing. Which node is publishing? The node with this sensor 100 is publishing some data. What data it is publishing now? Yes, please.
Zero.
So for every 2 seconds, it is publishing 1 and 0. 1 and 0, digital 1 indicates that is active, and digital 0 indicates this is inactive. It means on and off. So the node for every 2 seconds, it becomes on and off here. So that's what it is, a continuous process, and that is in the loop. It is a continuous process. It is for infinite. It is for forever. So this is what the publisher is going to do. So that program is this publisher program. So very simple program for you to understand. So what I do here is, so this is, I have given the name to this one. So I will just change this cup carbon to something like a new network. Oh, sorry. And I'm giving a new number here for this sensor. So this particular parameter, the first parameter indicates the topic name. The topic name should be the same, but the data values are getting changed here. So this is what I have given a file name as pub2, and I'm just saving it here. Similarly, now subscriber. Now this is a subscriber code. I'm just maximizing this one. Just hold on. So the subscriber code is this. So now you can see the subscriber code. So node is going to subscribe to a particular topic. So which is the topic? What is the topic name here? So I have given the topic as cup carbon 101 slash sensor 100. So the node is subscribed to this particular topic. And what is this happening to this? This subscriber is getting the information. whatever the publisher is giving, that information is getting, and it is being marked here. So that again, this particular, once you subscribe it, again, you are going to sleep for a certain duration. So this particular information, that is a subscriber logic. This is a script. This is a logic of the subscriber. Only thing is you need to understand the concept. The concept is there is a topic which has been made use for by the publisher and the subscriber. Both the publisher and the subscriber do contact or do exchange the information with the help of this topic, please. So the topic name is the topic name is going to be the most important thing for this particular MQTT protocol. So this is for the subscription, right? Now what I do here is, so I'll select one particular node that is on the right side. So I'm assigning the script. The script is, because on the right side it is a publisher, whatever the script I have written for the publisher, you just select the node, right click it, pub2.py, the Python program is assigned here. One second, I'm showing, please select the node, right click it, assign the script. So once you assign the script, you can go to the device parameters. In the device parameters, you can see the script file, pub2.py, and you click the right arrow. Once you click the right arrow, it means that script is loaded onto this particular node. Now, did we write any program to this subscriber nodes?
Yes.
No. We have written the program, but we have not written for this particular node. We have written the program, but what we are not embedded for that particular node. Embedded means we have not put the code onto that node. Yes. We have not firmware. Firmware means you put your program onto that particular hardware. So the hardware is this particular node. I'm selecting the left hand side node, IoT node one. So select the node, right click it. Can you see the assigned scripts is coming now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, yeah, assign scripts. Then now which particular script are you going to select?
Subscribe.
It is a subscriber. Okay, so 1 second. Sorry. It is a subscriber. So once you give, you see that gray color is changed to the red color, and you can see it on the left hand side, the script file, the sub2.py is added, and you click the right color. And of course, each node has got various parameters, the longitude, latitude, the elevation, the radius of this sensor node. So other parameters are there. You don't worry about other parameters in this experiment, but just keep an eye on these things. Later, when you come back to another experiment, I'll come back to that. Similarly, you need to add the subscription script, the subscription logic to the node 2. So select the node, assign the script, sub2.py. Similarly, select the node, the third node, select the script, assign the script. Select the node, right click it, assign the script. You can see it here, once it is not changed to red color means, see, since this is a simulator, it will take a little bit time to assign those things here. If you have put multiple devices there, then this is a problem here. Because while I'm talking, I just clicked multiple times for these devices. That's why I need to delete these things now. Now all four nodes are in the red color. So now your nodes are now active. If you see the devices, actually these are the devices, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What are the devices that you added into this workspace? That will be showing to you. And of course, now let us run the program here. So here on the right side, you have publisher, and on the left side, you have the subscribers. So just click the error in the simulation. One second, please. Simulation. There is a error in this particular configuration. So let me just trace it out. One second. And you just need to figure it out the problem here. One second, please. Devices which I added is giving me a problem here. So I just restarted once. There is an error coming from the console, failed to install Java. Okay. So let me just get back to the, I think some error is coming. Let me just reinstall it and I'll get back to you. One second. There is a problem with this simulator most of the time. That's why it's better to work with the real scenarios. It is getting some exception here. So just maybe the next time I'll try to demonstrate it, let me correct it from my system and I'll get back to you. But in meantime, you can also try to download it and install it. Let me install the other version, maybe. Okay. So for timing, just go through it, and once I install it, I will give the demonstration to you next week. So let me just move forward. So far we have seen these two layers. In fact, if you look to this generic diagram, so this smart things, and we discussed about sensors, actuators, and the gateways, the Raspberry Pi, Arduino board. How do you collect that sensor data, and how do you process that conversion from analog to digital? And what are the different types of sensors? What are the different types of actuators? And what are the different types of communication technologies that are being used to connect these devices together? So the left side, two different blocks, whatever you see, the blocks of networks, gateways, and smart things. We have covered a good amount of information has been already been passed on to you. So now you need to understand the right two blocks, the middleware and the applications. So the middleware, what is middleware and applications do exist, please, here? The middleware contains how do you store the data? How do you, how the data acquisition or how the data analytics are going to be done for that stored data? And how these particular things have been carried out at the cloud layers and all, that is what our syllabus is. So here we will be seeing the solution framework for various IoT applications. So how do you do the device integrations? How the data acquisition and integration do take place, how the device data storage takes place, and what are the various authentication and authorization of devices, and middleware, how that middleware is acting as a service for creating our applications and integrating our devices, how different multi-protocols or different communication protocols that we can apply it on our IoT application. And let us see how our artificial intelligence can be incorporated on those IoT things. So once we complete the third unit, then we will discuss it about the privacy and the security issues for various IoT data platforms. So that's what we will see, the security at the platform level, at the device levels, then followed by the case studies. So what I try to do is, my planning is, so we'll take this two to three case studies along with this, the third unit and the fourth unit together. So I will not specifically handle this. So I will include these case studies in this particular third unit and the fourth unit, so that you can understand the application wise, how the data is being processed and how the data is getting stored, and what are the various authentication and authorization of devices do takes place, how the middleware is helping for us, and how you can keep some security mechanisms, and how do you handle those security issues. So on and so forth. So the coming 12 to 6 means almost 18 hours. So out of 18 hours, I take almost some 10 to 12 hours only at the maximum. We have another 4 weeks. So those 4 weeks will constitute something like 12 hours. So those 12 hours, those 12 hours will definitely cover these two units, including this automation process, whatever the automation we do it, that is the application of IoT case studies. So I will, maybe if time permits, I will take all the 5 case studies, but if not, at least 2 case studies I will try to complete by incorporating these features. So this is how the plan for the coming just 4 weeks of time, because I will not take much than that. Most likely, as per the schedule, you have classes from, yes, already you have started. So you can see this as per this instruction from the school. So you will be having up to 20th July. Classes will happen up to 20th July. So I'm just taking 4 weeks from today onwards, so that the remaining topics can be covered and fairly good things can be delivered. So the remaining 1 or 2 weeks, I will just keep for either one for one assessment and for one week for the discussions. So as far as the practicals is concerned, so the practicals, I think most of you are familiarized with your Arduino and Raspberry Pi. So how to on LEDs, and the programs remains the same. Even if you don't have the real devices, at least if you're done through the simulators, the programs, the ideas, the concepts remains the same. So already you are done with the LEDs, you are done with the push buttons, you are done with the temperature and humidity readings. And of course, through simulators, you are done the interfacing with the motor. And of course, if you see the assignment 2 itself is on the SQL queries. So how do you connect, how do you retrieve, how do you upload the temperature humidity to the ThingSpeak cloud? And how do you retrieve it using your Python programs? And how do you store it locally on the MySQL? These three programs are basically your exercise 2 only. And of course, already I have shown you the demo, publish your temperature data to the MQTT, that was exercise 2. So as far as this last suggested exercises through simulators and through the real devices which you connected through online, you have done this at least maybe out of 12, you might have done at least 8 to 9 exercises that will give you a fair amount of knowledge and the skills to handle this. So if you forgot, please do recollect it. All the material is available. Start practicing it. So the coming third and fourth unit, so in this third and fourth unit, I will try to take care of this LoRaWAN and the Bluetooth also. Apart, because MQTT and ZigBee already have covered practically. So only thing is the Bluetooth and the LoRaWAN. I'm not going to discuss about TCP and UDP because everybody knows this TCP and UDP since your computer networks courses have covered most of the things. So my focus for the coming 4 weeks will be on to these two units and completing the syllabus, of course. So that is what my plan is. So please let me know if you have any doubts now. And of course, this the remaining two units, already this is in a nutshell, I have given this document to you. So please go through this document. And of course, the edge computing and the fog computing also, what is edge computing and fog computing? Already you might have known this information. So you can see in a broad way, you can have different devices where these edge nodes are very near to the data origin. So all the computations, all the processing takes place at this gateway level, at the Raspberry Pi level or at the other router levels itself. And you can see the data is completely sent to the clouds for the further processing for a wide set of devices that are getting connected. So we, in the third unit, we'll be basically discussing on the processing layer. Data processing means data that is getting processed. So how the data is getting accumulation, how the data abstraction takes place, what are the different IoT frameworks, how they view the data to be processed, and how the application layer is helpful for implementing various business decisions through data-driven solutions. And of course, the last is on the security layers. So you need not go through this particular topic of this document at this juncture from this last 4 pages, but at least up to this particular point is what we already covered. So each individual line, individual paragraph is got some material to you already given. Go through that, it will be a little bit in a more elaborate way. If you want a comprehensive way, you need to go to those respective books, the materials which I have shared to you. Please let me know if you have any queries for this session. Let me answer to you. And some of you, if you are using the Moodle continuously and if your eye is trained, so you can use this dark mode. You can make your Moodle websites to have the dark mode so that you will, your eye will not strain. So seeing the white screen most of the time on your laptops, even my eye is getting the strain. So even I put this dark mode so that you can, in the night times and in the during the day times also, this dark mode will help you for you to not to strain your eyes very much. So again, if you are using Moodle, you can put the dark mode. So not only for the Moodle, if you want to go for your anything, this emails and all, so everything that will be helpful for you. Please let me know any queries. I think this is going in the infinite loop. Let me stop present here. Yes, please. Hello, am I audible to you?
Yes, sir.
Please let me know if you have any queries. Let me answer to you. We have another 4 minutes of time.
Sir, we need the read API key for that MQTT channel you are posting DHT data on.
Read API key.
Yes, sir. For subscribe, we need
a
read API key.
Sorry?
For subscribe operation, we need a read API key, sir.
You can publish the data, no? You can publish your own page and you can try to retrieve it from there.
Okay.
You need not look for my page itself. That's what you have to, that's what this exercise, one exercise which I given, you need to upload the data and you need to retrieve the data. That will be helpful for you. One exercise will be there. That will be helpful for both the things. I hope I'm, I have given the clarity for you.
Yes, sir. And the SQL data, sir, it should be on your SQL DB, sir, or?
No, the SQL DB is already on the Raspberry Pi.
Yes, sir. Okay.
SQL DB is there on the Raspberry Pi. You need to create your own. See, are you able to see my screen now? The Raspberry Pi screen? 1 second. Are you able to see my screen now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So here we can connect to this putty. Forgot that you are 1 second. See, sometimes my things gets stuck here. That's why it will recreate it and the connection is going to be established. So please look on to this URLs and the IP address from this point, then you can connect it then. So this is 15160. So in your in the Raspberry Pi, when you connect here, I forgot the root password here. You can, I think.
Sir, trying with sudo might work, sir.
One second. All right. Once you connect to your Raspberry Pi, your MySQL database, you can connect. Of course, this is a MariaDB. No problem. You can create your own databases here. You might have studied in your database course how to create your own databases, right?
Yes, sir.
So you create your own database here with your ID number.
Sir, so you know, root in database has no password, no, sir?
I think there is no password here. That's why you see, no, it has not asked password for me. Just it has entered. I did not keep any constraint, I remember. You can directly connect to this one.
Okay, sir.
So create your own database here, and in the database, create your own table, and you can put your collected data into that table. And from that table, you can publish it to the ThingSpeak cloud, or you can visualize it, anything you can do it. I'm just given the database for you to do this one. Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
See, like this, create database NKS. You see, so once you create your database, you can use NKS. Now in this NKS, what is will be there at present? Nothing will be there. Show tables. Nothing is. It is empty. Can't you create a table here? You don't know how to create a table. Create table, table name. You know DDL commands and DML commands of your database.
Yes, sir. Yes.
You know how to insert the data. See, you can write your Python script to put the data into this database now. What is wrong in this?
Yes, I will do it.
So once you put your sensor data onto your database table, my idea is for you to get an idea how to collect the sensor data and put it store locally and publish it to the cloud so that you can get a track of publishing the data from the local system to the cloud. That is enough. That idea is enough for at present in this course. Okay.
Okay.
So any other queries, please?
No,
sir. Yeah. So I will just wind up the session for today, and we'll meet again on Tuesday, right?
Yes, sir.
Right. So yeah, please take care of yourself, and we'll meet on Tuesday. So I will continue with the third unit, and I hope you got the track now. And please go through the previous materials. Don't lose the out of focus. Don't get out of the focus of the course. That will create a problem for you in the later stages. So of course, I will keep one test. Already you have completed one test and two. I'm assuming that second assignment is also completed. So two assignments and one test is completed as far as the assessment is concerned, right?
Yes, sir.
One minor test and two assignments are completed. Am I clear to you? Am I okay?
Yes, sir.
So there will be one more test. That is the only one test will be there. After another 3 weeks, we will conduct the test. So two tests and two minor tests. That's enough for this course. Is it okay?
Okay, okay, sir.
Yeah, so please make a note of that one. I'll inform the test before 2 weeks when we conduct their test. So apart from that, that is only assessment, the local means the continuous assessment. And of course, we'll see how the final exam, how the department decides and when they are going to be scheduled for the major exam. That I cannot say at this moment. But we have only one more. I'm assuming the two assignments are submitted and already one minor test is completed. So we will have one more component that is related to third unit, and that completes the continuous assessment from my side. Okay, is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. So then we will meet on Tuesday. Okay, right.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Please take care of yourself. Yeah.